everyone. Welcome to our third panel on corporations and global markets. I introduce our moderator, Kenji Yoshino. Kenji is a professor here at, he is our Chief Justice Earl Warren Professor of Constitutional Law. He went to Harvard, Oxford, and Yale Law School and has been teaching since 1998.
Thank you so much, Laura, for that introduction. I'm deeply honored to have this distinguished panel with me today. I should say that I regret that one of our panelists is unable to make it for weather reasons. So we have Doug Kahn, Cynthia Esland, and Michael Guest on our panel. So I'm going to begin by introducing Doug Kahn. So Doug Kahn is the principal of the Kahn Group, which is a corporate responsibility consultancy. And he is also the president of Clear Voices, a service that ensures communication between factory and farm managers and their workforces. If this gives you any sense of the kind of beginning of Mr. Kahn's accomplishments, let me also add that prior to that, he was at Reebok International, and he expressed his bona fides as a warrior for corporate social responsibility there by making sure that they complied with various international human rights practices. And he's also currently a member of the board of directors of Verite, a nonprofit research and advocacy organization dedicated to humanizing the global workplace. So I can think of no better person to kick off our panel on the global workplace and corporate social responsibility. So Doug Kahn.
Well, thank you all. It's a delight to be here, and it's just been a fascinating day to listen to the comments of some of the other panelists, and delighted to participate in this way. Now, the obligation of enterprises, companies, to respect human rights has been most recently articulated in the Framework for Business and Human Rights, put forward by John Ruggie, the Special Representative to the Secretary General of the United Nations. And in his 2008 report, Ruggie proposed a framework for human rights and business based on three pillars. The first pillar is for the state duty to protect human rights, to protect against human rights abuses by third parties, the state duty to protect. The second, Ruggie argues and puts forth, is that it is the obligation of business to respect human rights. And finally, greater access by victims to effective remedies is the third leg of the framework. And these principles together represent and reinforce a rights-compatible approach. Now, Ruggie's groundbreaking mandate did not end in 2008 when he submitted the framework back to the UN. In fact, his mandate was extended until this year, actually June of this year, in order for him to operationalize and promote it. And the results of Ruggie's additional work are guiding principles and were circulated in draft form just this past December. They provide the concrete and practical recommendations for the framework's implementation. The guiding principles draw on extensive research and pilot projects carried out in several industry sectors and countries, two of which I had the privilege to be involved in. Now, Ruggie's framework comes at a time when leading global companies acknowledge their responsibilities for the business impacts they have, even though they often occur in enterprises that they neither own nor operate in supply chains, but arguably have some influence over as a result of their commercial relationships. So today, leading global corporations spend considerable time and money to manage those impacts, first by understanding the nature of their supply chains, second, by assessing the human rights conditions within them, and third, often working in a collaborative fashion, seeking to redress shortcomings that have been identified. Today, complex supply chains and difficult political and community environments add complexity, for sure, to the implementation of even the most thoughtful corporate responsibility initiatives. It's complicated. We live in a time when violations of internationally recognized human rights continue to fester in every corner of the globe, even when the private sector exerts enormous influence, and when governments are often weak and ineffective at addressing rights violations. In fact, governments have in many cases become an impediment to company efforts to respect human rights. In these cases, companies have petitioned governments or international agencies to place a stronger regulatory role, kind of ironic in some respects, in as much as to do otherwise would place an undue burden on companies and is not likely to protect rights. In other words, companies cannot do it alone. So in these complex social, business, and national political settings, what are the challenges and opportunities that enterprises face in applying the Ruggie framework? Well, to begin, two overarching observations. The first is the Ruggie framework exempts no enterprise, be it a Fortune 100 company like General Electric, Microsoft, or Walmart, or a microenterprise selling vegetables on the streets in Nepal, or stitching sweaters, homework-based work in Peru. Whether it's a government-owned enterprise in Vietnam or a coal mine owned by a global conglomerate operating under state license in Colombia. A farm at one end of the supply chain or the grocer who sells the produce 6,000 miles away. Ruggie presents us with a truly one-size-fits-all solution. The second observation I would make is that the Ruggie framework does not allow companies to pick and choose which of the elements it wishes to engage. The company obligation to respect necessarily involves the support of an interlocking obligations to perform due diligence and to address remedies. To the extent that companies engage in the process of identifying, responding, and communicating about some of the impacts of what companies are doing about them but not others, Ruggie motivates them to expand their scope of work and broaden the range of activities undertaken. So what precisely are the Ruggie obligations in the Ruggie framework for enterprises that we're talking about? So in short, it is a company's ability to know and show that is at the core of respecting human rights in all its business operations. In order for a company to be aware of and address negative human rights impacts, Ruggie calls on enterprises to conduct due diligence. Enterprises can do this by engaging in four distinct areas of activity. First, adopt human rights policies. Enterprises are to adopt human rights policies that reference the Declaration of Human Rights and ILO core conventions, providing enough detail in these policies so that they are meaningful in the company's various functions. The policies are to be endorsed by top management, identify who is responsible, and relay expectations the company has to its employees and its partners, its business partners, down the supply chain. Second, integrating human rights policies throughout the company. Not something we see enough of, in my opinion. Once the policies have been adopted, they are to be communicated internally and externally to all employees, business partners, and other relevant stakeholders. Management must take ownership of the policies, and employees must be trained in order to have the capacity to respond to situations as they arise. The third is identifying how the enterprise's current or potential activities impact human rights. It's part of the know. We have to know what our human rights impacts are. Enterprises must conduct monitoring to ascertain their human rights impacts and performance, and performance is to be tracked. It's to be tracked with qualitative and quantitative metrics. Ideally, businesses are to share information and best practices in order to benefit the industry and ultimately themselves. Fourth, finally, is communicating performance. When relevant stakeholders express concerns, enterprises are called on to communicate about how they respond to actual or potential human rights impacts. Reporting provides enterprises with a sense of accountability to stakeholders. Transparency also allows for institutional learning on how to better address human rights abuses in the future. The third and final component of the Ruggie mandate is the framework, he notes, is about remedy. He notes that enterprises must make provisions for those who believe their rights have been harmed to report this to the company and seek remediation. Thus, part of the corporate responsibility for respecting human rights is to provide access to remedies. While grievances against enterprises often play out through litigation or public advocacy campaigns against a company, it is often more advantageous for enterprises to be proactive and to seek to identify and remedy grievances before they get to that point. So what does Ruggie say? He says that grievance mechanisms at the enterprise level should conform to the principles of legitimacy, accessibility, predictability, rights compatibility, equitability, transparency. Company level mechanisms should also operate through dialogue and mediation, so as not to act as judge and jury. As part of the corporate responsibility to respect, grievance mechanisms help identify, mitigate, and possibly resolve grievances before they escalate and more harm is done. So I want to take all of this Ruggie framework, protect, respect, remedy, and pose that question I asked a few minutes ago. What are the challenges and the opportunities that enterprises face in applying the Ruggie framework? And examine that in one real world case. And I thought it would be useful, with the help of my colleague Mike Sheehy, who's in the room, to look at the case of Bangladesh. Now, Bangladesh is a desperately poor country. It is beset by political corruption, endemic terrorism, extrajudicial murder, environmental degradation. Development has been hobbled by poor leadership, limited resources. The apparel, or ready-made garment industry, as it's called there, has grown up steadily since the mid-1970s, to the point where now it employs about 3 million people directly. And then there are many others, many millions others, who are employed indirectly. Problems in the sector range from child labor, forced labor, excessive working hours, limitations on workers' rights to freedom of association. Wages in Bangladesh at the bottom of the list for garment manufacturing around the world in terms of exporting countries. Minimum wage was raised in 2010. $43 a month. Workers have very few avenues to bargain collectively or to organize themselves into effective unions. Thus, the ready-made garment industry in Bangladesh is a very challenging context for discussing the application of the Ruggie framework and leads to other questions. How effectively can a brand or a retailer half a world away monitor conditions? How can they really know, as Ruggie calls on us to do? How can a brand or retailer support or enable freedom of association when governments and industry-wide activities provide roadblocks to do that, no matter how well-intentioned the brand or retailer is? What are the strategies for success where typical compliance activities like auditing and corrective actions, et cetera, may not engender positive results? And so, we have to understand the application of Ruggie in difficult circumstances in the context of supply chains. And so here's one way of thinking about a supply chain through a brand perspective. You know, the relationship between a brand or retailer and that worker whose rights we're respecting as corporations is also complex. Brands or retailers typically place orders through agents or full package manufacturers or contracts in a demand-driven supply chain. And only the most cynical will believe that these business relations were created with the intention of depressing workers' rights. Nevertheless, in the interest of business efficiency and effectiveness, and in part in response to the regulation of global apparel through differential trade and tariff regimes, brands and retailers often find themselves in a position of having multiple relationships and intermediaries and interlocutors between themselves and those workers. And this remains a very complex and dynamic situation. It's also dynamic because Bangladesh isn't the only place where garments can be sewn. And so there's a moving around of factories and order downloads from country to country. So while much time could be spent on this subject alone, suffice to say, supply chain models that are deployed by brands and retailers for very good reason, they don't make it easy when it comes to knowing and showing respect for human rights. Now, Ruggie provides us with a terrific tool here to help us answer some of these questions. And to apply this matrix that you see up on the screen, Ruggie explains that it doesn't matter how much or how little business you do with the supplier, the factory. Instead, what matters is the extent that the factory is important to the brand or retailer's business, and the extent that the enterprise has leverage. Simply put, leverage is the ability of the brand or retailer to affect change on the factory floor. Is there leverage? So you take a look at the top left corner, and you've got scenario A. And in scenario A, we see that the supply chain entity, the factory, is crucial to the brand or retailer. And the brand or retailer possesses leverage. And in this case, the brand or retailer must exercise that leverage to mitigate the abuse. This is precisely what leading brands and retailers do, or attempt to do. They create a code of conduct. They use it as the basis for establishing expectations. They create assessment tools and techniques for determining the extent of compliance. They develop capacity building programs. All the leading brands and retailers do this today. They engage stakeholders in two-way communication. There's a great deal going on. In concerted efforts at mitigation prove unsuccessful, and the logical conclusion is that the leverage wasn't what we thought it was. And so you go to scenario B, the top right-hand corner. And here, the factory is crucial to the brand or retailer, but the leverage, not so much. So despite all the steps I just mentioned, we have to find ways to increase the leverage. And if we can't find ways to increase the leverage through collaborative actions with other brands or retailers, or by petitioning governments to create regulatory mechanisms that would create a level playing field for all and to police them, then we're faced with a situation of getting out. And getting out means the loss of jobs. So it's a last resort. It's a last resort. Scenario C, the bottom left, here the factory's not crucial to the brand or retailer, but there is influence. And you know, this may be the easiest of all the scenarios because you exercise the influence. You make a difference. You lift the standards in that factory. And it's not so crucial to the company anyway, but you decide to invest the resources. Now, it may not be the best use of resources if you have a limited pot of money and resources to do that with, but here you have the leverage, and therefore you're called upon to exercise it. And in the bottom right, you don't have leverage, but it's not crucial. So here you are in a situation where leaving that facility may be the best option. But I have two observations about scenario D, the bottom right. The first is, Ruggie says you still have to know and show. So you still have to explain why you got out. And that means you have to document and know about it. But the other is that the issue of unauthorized subcontracting, do you really know? And it's widespread in this sector and many others. So you might be producing, your products might be produced on your behalf in that facility, and you don't know about it. So unauthorized subcontracting falls into that bottom right category, and you may not even know it, but you certainly have no leverage over it, because how can you have leverage if you don't know? So Ruggie provides us with rich thought in all of these areas. But having said all of that, none of these observations about the complexity of the supply chain or the difficult problems in the ready-made garment sector in Bangladesh in general are meant to diminish the value of Ruggie's framework for brands and retailers or to discourage companies from applying the framework in their business operations. On the contrary, the clarity that Ruggie brings to these vexing questions about the appropriate role of business in the context of human rights is really quite refreshing. Nonetheless, the task of taking seriously the obligation to respect will result in reflection and an ordering of priorities, even for the most highly evolved companies' corporate responsibility programs. And in so doing, I offer these preliminary observations. Companies will benefit from collaborative platforms, such as the Better Work Program, the program of the International Labor Organization, to country by country identify standards and apply them across a sector, not factory by factory, but across the sector. Small and medium enterprises will need to pay special attention to that collaborative approach because they may not have the resources to know and show processes to the same extent as larger businesses. Weak governments, underdeveloped civil society sectors overseas place burdens on business. Capacity building and an alignment of roles of all sectors will be an important step for Bangladesh and in many, many other countries. And finally, at the end of the day, I would argue, the very process of engaging in respecting rights can lead to an enhanced understanding of business risk. Mitigating those risks is consistent with businesses' need for stability and predictability. And this is really one of the clear ways that in which an enterprise's obligation to respect rights and good business go hand in hand. So with that as introductory comments, I leave you with the thought that that I have a great deal of respect for what the Ruggie framework has to offer, and that I have a great deal of respect for how complicated it will be to apply it in countries around the world.
Thank you so much, Doug. It was a great presentation. So it's now my great privilege to introduce our second speaker, Cynthia Esland. Cindy is the Catherine A. Rain Professor of Law here at NYU School of Law. She's one of our most beloved colleagues and teachers, winner of the Podell Teaching Award not so long ago. She is an expert on labor and employment law, and she has made two enormous contributions in the forms of books in this field. The first of these was called Working Together, How Workplace Bonds Strengthen a Diverse Democracy. That was published by Oxford University Press in 2003. As some of you may hear in the title, there's a riff off of the Putnam bowling alone idea. So the idea is that Putnam worries about how there's a decline in social capital that leads to us bowling alone, which is something that we never used to do. And Esland's book says, actually, one of the places where we reverse the spin of this difficulty is in the workplace, where we can actually work together. So workplaces are one of the places where people of very diverse backgrounds are still engaging in consociational activity with each other. More recently, just this past year, she published another major work, Regoverning the Workplace, this time published by Yale University Press. And here she talks about the current crisis in labor and employment law due to the decline of both collecting bargaining strategies and of litigation and legislative and regulatory activities. So without any further ado, I give you Cynthia Esland.
Gosh, I wonder what that would have, how long that would have lasted if I hadn't told Kenji to keep it short. Thank you very much. That was a very kind introduction. So I am going to talk about corporations and global markets, lessons from the anti-sweatshop movement. But I'm not a participant in the anti-sweatshop movement, unlike Doug, who has been a sort of soldier in the fields for many years. So on the page to practice spectrum, I'm very much on the page side. So let me step back by asking a really basic question. How can corporations improve people's lives in the developing world? Mainly, although not exclusively, in two ways. One, by bringing much-needed capital and jobs and economic development to poor countries. And two, by conducting their operations in responsible ways that respect human rights, worker and community interests, and the natural environment. It's worth pausing for just a moment to think about the relationship between those two mechanisms by which corporations can do good in the developing world. First of all, the first one is a predicate for the second. Establishing operations and supply chains in the developing world is a predicate for responsible management of those supply chains. And that reminds us there's some tension between those two mechanisms. Corporations extend their supply chains to poor countries to lower the cost of production. They have powerful incentives to resist additional costs that are sometimes associated with respecting human rights, with respecting and advancing worker and community interests, and the natural environment. If those costs are high enough, in fact, corporations may take their capital and jobs elsewhere, or may threaten to do so. They may threaten to go someplace even cheaper. So that's where we get the dreaded race to the bottom, by which corporations are said to seek out ever lower cost, less regulated environments, and poor countries compete for much needed capital by keeping wages and regulatory burdens down. So in China, for example, as workers have successfully pressed for higher wages and better labor standards, corporations talk increasingly quite loudly about moving their operations to Bangladesh or Vietnam. Now, from a global justice perspective, that's probably a good thing. It would be even better if they started talking about moving those jobs to Africa. But the reason they're not moving to Africa and the reason they're not going to move everything to Bangladesh and Vietnam, well, first of all, there's not enough workers. But for now, much of the work that's been in China is going to stay in China, although it might move to the provinces, it might move off the coast, because China still offers the best combination of low wages, skilled workers, and good infrastructure. So there's lessons in this. Some of what we see is not really a race to the bottom. It's what I'd like to call, and I want you to remember that I said this, race to the rising bottom. That captures something about what's actually happened through, you know, globalization. The flow of capital to poor countries actually contributes to the development of skills, infrastructure, and even governance and regulatory institutions, as well as higher wages. And those improvements can offset, through productivity increases, some of the higher labor costs, higher costs of production. So indeed, to the extent that better labor standards do or can go hand in hand with increased productivity and efficiency, that expands the space for pressuring corporations to raise wages and improve working conditions, to push for socially responsible supply chain practices. So let's look at the experience of the anti-sweatshop movement, veterans of the corporate social responsibility movement, in trying to improve labor standards in supplier factories of multinational corporations. Doug's talked about layers of complexity that I'm not going to be able to touch on here. There's plenty of complexity left to talk about, though. So as I said this morning, if you were here, global supply chains create and reflect vast private transnational regulatory capacity. Corporations have developed that capacity in order to speed and cheapen the flow of goods from to their consumers, where they pick up profits along the way. So, but of course, we figured out a while back that those supply chains can be deployed to regulate production processes in the interest of workers and communities. If only the multinationals can be motivated to do that. The global supply chains have been crucial to the motivation part of the story as well, because those supply chains link rich world consumers like us with very poor workers and communities who elicit our sympathy. So advocates for those workers and communities can expose conditions under which branded shoes, clothes, toys, and cell phones are produced. And we carry those things around, and we have to think about that. So they showed poor workers, sometimes children, sewing Nike swooshes on sneakers. That's a big image that stuck. So in other words, they have to trouble the conscience of those rich world consumers and somehow transform ephemeral moral sentiments into reputational pressures that can hurt corporations' brand. And yes, there's even an app for that. So Good Guides, which was developed by some academics initially, is an effort to make information about production processes available to consumers when they're deciding which product to buy. At least for the first few decades, though, and we can ask whether this is still true, the anti-sweatshop movement has been perilously dependent on the sometimes fickle moral calculus of privileged Western consumers, especially students who may be even more fickle than most of us. Given that, they've accomplished far more than I think that we would have thought possible, although still less than we might have hoped. So one lesson is that the corporate social responsibility movement, in order to itself become sustainable, needs to tap into other motivational sources that are not strictly based on consumers, but regulatory resources, public regulatory resources in the governments where those factories are located, and workers who have some potential to exert pressure in their own countries. I'm not going to get to deal much with those possibilities, but that's an important lesson. So CSR proponents pursued both an outside game and an inside game in order to motivate multinationals. The outside game, again, tries to galvanize public and consumer sentiment against, or sometimes in favor of, corporate reputation and brand and products on the basis of conditions or practices in the corporation's supply chain or operations. So scandals and revelations of inhumane working conditions, child labor, forced labor, persecution or murder of labor activists in one supply chain, that can arouse public outrage, bruise or scar the corporate brand, or trigger a boycott. So on the other side, exemplary programs can earn a sweat-free label or a fair trade label and the favor of consumers. The outside game works in tandem with the inside game, by which one part of the inside game involves shareholders, which include large pension funds that we heard a little bit about a few moments ago, and socially responsible investors that can press firms to adopt socially responsible positions and programs or to live up to the statements they've already made about their social responsibility. Even small shareholders that can't exert pressure through financial markets can utilize SEC rules that allow shareholders to place proposals on proxy statements, put those in front of corporate directors, who then sometimes make concessions just to not have to bother with the embarrassment and trouble of dealing with these proposals. Another inside game, ultimately probably more important, kicks in once a firm staffs its in-house corporate social responsibility program. So to be credible, in-house CSR folks need to be linked up with and be almost credentialed by a growing professional corporate social responsibility movement out there that has its own sense of ethics and its own knowledge of best practices in promoting corporate social responsibility. Within the firm, then, those corporate social responsibility folks, the staff, they become an internal constituency, much like the constituency for diversity and inclusion, pressing inside the corporation to take seriously the corporate social responsibility movements that firms have been moved to make by those outside pressures. So these outside and inside strategies are intertwined, obviously. Outsiders' threat of bad publicity or the promise of good publicity motivates corporate managers and directors to accede to some of the demands, the internal demands of shareholders, socially responsible shareholders, or staff. In other words, the outside pressures and the potential impact on market share and share price help insiders make the business case for social responsibility that ultimately is what's probably needed to move things forward. So what that means is that firms that initially perhaps, you know, 20 years ago, perhaps they hoped to deflect those outside pressures by making superficial commitments to corporate social responsibility. They found themselves, that just turned out to be the first step down a path toward serious investments in procedures that back up those commitments, because skillful advocates were able to deploy this combined inside-outside strategy to ratchet up the level of commitment and resources. There's been a fair amount of success, I think, in motivating corporations. Doug had quite a lot of very useful information and analysis about the other side of the problem. It turns out that motivating multinational corporations is not the whole challenge. However challenging that is, it is equally challenging to effectively monitor suppliers with their own very powerful economic incentives to hold on to contracts that they got by underbidding the competition, right? There has been a gradual ratcheting up of both the substance and the process of corporate social responsibility anti-sweatshop type codes of conduct, both the content and the backup, the procedural backup. There's been lots of failures, many stumbles along the way, but really not any retreat in what is demanded of corporations. So corporations have found themselves subjected to a changing best practices standard. And so we've gone from vague substantive commitments to more detailed codes of conduct that incorporate international labor standards and domestic legal standards, including increasingly that most indigestible of worker rights, and that is freedom of association, the right to form a union. So we've gone from just paper codes of conduct with no monitoring to ritualistic monitoring by monitors that have a stake in finding compliance to unannounced inspections by independent monitors. That's been a long struggle to get from point A to point C. From no role for workers themselves in the factories to an increasing recognition of the necessary role of educating workers and empowering them to enforce their own labor standards, though that's an area in which there is there's been far too little progress. Still, there's a growing consensus with all these improvements that the existing monitoring model has largely failed within the context of a supply chain strategy of playing dozens or hundreds of suppliers off against one another to secure the lowest bids. Monitors swoop in periodically to police suppliers for compliance with standards of conduct that are sometimes not realistic given local standards, but especially given the cost-squeezing contract prices that contractors have been paying. It sets up this sort of policing compliance model, sets up a cat and mouse game, and it has created an entire secondary industry of deception. So suppliers hire firms that offer a money-back guarantee that you will pass your audit by producing fake books, often multiple sets of fake books, to comport with different codes of conduct by different corporations, and coaching workers and motivating workers to say what needs to be said during the inspections. There has been some movement toward a new supply chain strategy of closing and shrinking the set of suppliers, forming closer and more durable organizational and operational ties with that smaller set of suppliers, and building up worker productivity so that they can actually afford to pay better wages and maintain decent conditions. That's a very, very complex story. The whole story that I'm telling here is very complicated, but the labor side of that, in order to fit that with improving labor standards, the effort is to shift from a policing compliance model to a model based on transparency, toward enabling workers to speak up for themselves, honesty about where the suppliers have fallen short, and a commitment to continuous improvement. So in other words, there's some effort to get multinationals to sign on to this new strategy by which they go to their now, they say, we'll make a commitment to you. We're going to invest in you and try to improve your capacity. You need to be honest with us about where the problems are. We'll help you solve those problems. We're not going to toss you out for the next round of contracting. But you just need to show us that that conditions are actually continuing to improve. It's a very challenging model to sell, and partly it's challenging because the stakeholder community needs to adjust as well. They need to start rewarding companies. If that's the right model, which I think has a lot to be said for it, then they have to change their strategy from a gotcha scandal-based strategy of exposing noncompliance to a strategy that rewards transparency and continuous improvement. So I hope that some of the lessons of the anti-sweatshop campaign that might be carried over into especially things like sustainability, efforts to improve sustainability in the developing world. I hope some of those have become obvious along the way. The only one that I will underscore is that, and that's one of the larger lessons here, I think, supply chains can become effective vehicles for improving human and environmental outcomes if the strategy for promoting social outcomes fits with and is integrated with the supply chain strategy itself. Both the social responsibility strategy and the outsourcing supply chain strategy may need to change in order to bring about that better fit and that better integration. Thanks very much.
And thank you so much, Cindy, for that fantastic talk. Wow. So it's now my great honor to introduce our final panelist, Ambassador Michael Guest, who is the co-founder of the Council for Global Equality, which is a coalition of organizations that works for LGBT rights, both in the United States and abroad. I first had the occasion to hear Michael speak when he was presenting a very important paper published by the Council called Anchoring Equality about the roles that corporations can play, particularly multinational corporations can play, in the advancement of LGBT rights around the world. And so I insisted when the symposium editors came to me that he would be a wonderful panelist to have on this particular conversation. I have to also admit that Michael is a personal hero of mine, given that he served for 26 years in the Foreign Service and the State Department, rising to the level both of ambassador and as dean of the State Department's Leadership and Management School. But then he resigned in protest over the discriminatory policies of the State Department, in the way that the State Department was treating its LGBT members, particularly the domestic partners of their personnel. Not only did he resign in an extremely principled fashion from a very high post, you know, I keep thinking, where would gay rights be right now if, you know, every single person showed this kind of integrity? But he also fixed the problem that he resigned over. So when he was part of President Obama's transition team, he made sure that that policy was altered. So Secretary of State Clinton has now undone the damage, and we've achieved equality for LGBT members of, or LGB, I should say, Foreign Service employees. So with all that said, I'm delighted to welcome Ambassador Guest to the podium, and I hope you'll give him a warm welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Kenji. It may interest some of you to know that when I told my parents that I was coming to speak at NYU, there was this long pause, and then my mother said, well, I bet that makes you feel smart. And so I took that as a poke in my ribs, but a tip of the hat to NYU, which is a great university, and so I pass it on to you for that reason. And I also think it appropriate to say thank you to Megan and Laura for their work and all the colleagues' work at putting together what's been a growing experience, I think, for all of us. And it's a fascinating overlay of people from corporate America, people from the activist sphere, from academia, and from the legal profession. So thank you for doing that. I have two distinct vantage points for our conversation this afternoon. And the first is my experience, as Kenji mentioned, in the State Department, serving as a US diplomat, where I had ample opportunities to see how corporations can act to pursue change abroad when they want to do so and when they see it in their self-interest. And the second is the current advisory role that I play with the Council for Global Equality, where we're pushing federal and corporate representatives to adopt policies that advance fair and equal treatment for gay and transgender individuals abroad. And many of my observations will be focused through the latter lens, but I think that they do apply more broadly to corporate America's role on any issue that involves progressive social change abroad. Now, in many of my public presentations, I tend to focus on the importance of standing on principle. And I want to use that as a starting point for this conversation today for two reasons. The first is that social change tends to be rooted in principle. Human rights are for all people. They're not just for the people who are part of your ethnic group or your religious community. A wealthy world shouldn't allow people to starve. Workplace rules and benefits should be fair and equal for all employees, those kinds of things. And the second reason pertains, I think, directly to our conversation, and it's that principle very often frames the gap between what corporations can do abroad and what they actually do. As much as anything, it was that gap that propelled me into a diplomatic career instead of a corporate career 30 years ago. I felt that my job as a diplomat would be to advance policies that were grounded in principle, things like equality and fairness and rule of law, and respect for fundamental civil and human rights abroad, the deepest beliefs that we as a country claim to have. And before any of you storm this podium, which I can see happening quite easily, I will readily agree that America has not always stood up to those principles that we claim to profess many, many times. The political scales are not weighted the same way as the scales of justice are. But I would argue that even when we've fallen short on those policies, diplomats on the ground in countries around the world spend an inordinate amount of time trying to understand and change the impediments to real democracy and to respect for human rights and to the fight against corruption and other kinds of social goals that affect not only our national interests but also the lives of real people overseas. And so I see diplomacy at its heart as an activist pursuit. And that's also true of the NGO sphere. And both are about changing minds and perceptions and about using our influence and our tools, such as foreign assistance, whether it's public or private, to widen opportunities for people who are marginalized in society. And I'll come back to that at the end of the presentation. So what about the corporate sector? What do we see when we look there? Well, there are companies that have stood on principle, and I want to acknowledge that up front, at times. And in doing so, they have contributed to social change. And I go back to my childhood in South Carolina, where 50 years or more ago, IBM opened operations in the Research Triangle Park area of North Carolina. When it did, it insisted that African Americans be allowed to be on management track in those operations. Local officials didn't like it. They resisted. IBM insisted. And they needed jobs in the area. And so ultimately the local officials caved. Now that, to me, is a position of principle on IBM's part and one that I know contributed to my native South's improvement, changing it for the better. So why don't we see that same clarity of conscience when it comes to corporate activities overseas? Is it enough for IBM or any other American company, I'm not picking on IBM, to offer gender pay parity in, say, Saudi Arabia? Or should we expect that IBM and other companies would go further and insist that women be allowed to serve in leadership positions in keeping with our beliefs? And why don't companies make a point of recruiting both deliberately and visibly in ethnic communities and countries where there is deep-seated prejudice? And why do so few of the companies that score very well in terms of their treatment of gay and transgender employees here in the United States fail to carry those same policies to their operations overseas? Now, I ask these questions as a realist. I want to put that forward. I'm not an activist who just thinks of great things and detaches them from reality. I do realize that corporations don't tend to see themselves as agents of social change. They don't see social change as their mission, in other words. And in fact, a number of corporate representatives have used words essentially to that effect in our conversations about gay and transgender workplace issues abroad. Companies are concerned, as we've heard today from many speakers, about market share and IPOs and corporate image and brand name and profits and all of those things. That doesn't mean, though, that they can't do some good on social issues. It doesn't mean that they don't necessarily care at some level or that some of the executives don't care. And when social change involves controversy, very often companies are very quick to look the other way. They see this as a minefield, particularly with certain consumer groups. And so they would much rather involve themselves to the degree possible in something that's more benign, something called corporate social responsibility. I'm high on corporate social responsibility. I think it's a great thing. But overseas, the examples of corporate social responsibility I've seen have tended to be rather limited. They've been providing internship opportunities, contributing money to a local charity, building a marketplace for local artisans and farmers, maybe providing cell phones to rural schools. And all of these things are good, and I don't want to minimize them, but they don't tend to result in what I would call social change. I think more relevant to our discussions today is a different thing that I've seen from US companies abroad. I've seen many, many instances in which American companies actually roll up their sleeves and come up with work plans and action groups to try to promote a change in a business climate issue. And this, in fact, is one of the greatest areas of synergy between US embassies on the one hand and American and multinational corporations on the other. The motive in these efforts tends to be self-effort, I think we have to, or self-interest, I think we have to realize that. Things like to reduce red tape or lower operating costs or speed the passage of goods through customs. But the end result is a material change in the way business is done. And that is a change that's good not only for the companies, not only good for American interests, it's good for local businesses and consumers as well. And so this is kind of where I want to take our conversation. You know, how can we apply that model of corporate engagement, sort of the roll up the sleeves and work at it and get it done effort, to the need for companies to be more active in fostering social change? Now, as already been mentioned, I've been involved in a range of issues with the Council for Global Equality related to fair and equal treatment for gay and transgender people overseas. And one of the focuses that we've had has been to urge that companies, American companies, with overseas operations adopt fair workplace policies for gay and transgender employees in their overseas operations. So let's take that, if you will, as a bit of a case study. There are two issues, quite distinct, quite different, that are at play on the issue of gay and transgender employment policy abroad. The first is the issue of how corporations accommodate the families of gay employees when an American employee is assigned or transferred overseas. And the second issue is that of the homophobic climates in which gay and transgender employees, whether American or foreign, have to live and work overseas. And those are very, very different in their nature. The first issue, how gay families are treated in transfer policies, really should be fairly easy. There's, from my standpoint, there's absolutely no logical reason that two employees who are working side by side, one gay, one straight, both with families, with a different nature perhaps, but both with families, should be treated differently when it comes to an overseas transfer. They have the same conditions of employment, and in general, there tends to be no legal impediment, at least in the private sector, to treating them equally. But there's a study by KPMG about a year ago that showed that only 44% of companies, American companies doing business globally, provided relocation-related benefits to same-sex partners of company employees. Now, KPMG points out in the study that that's an uptick from a decade earlier when the figure was 17%. So 17 a year, 10 years ago, 44 now. They also say that this is the fastest changing area in global benefits. There are reasons for that that are clear. We don't have to talk about them in detail. Obviously, gays have become more out, more open, more vocal in demanding equal treatment. There's a new generation, many of you among them, that are of young folks who are looking at their conditions of employment. They're not wedded to staying with the same firm forever the way my father and grandfather were. I've just put myself in your category of young there, you notice that. And talent mobility is also a major issue in the global workforce and in the global market. But for me, the issue is not, wow, it's gone from 17 to 44, it's why isn't it 100? What's with the other 56% out there? After all, it should be in corporate America's interest to work to keep the employees that they've tried to train. They've tried to advance. They've tried to make sure that these employees are part of their workforce at more senior levels. And it should be in the corporate America's interest to make sure that the right people with the right skills and the right talents, wherever they may be, can be moved to the places they need to move them, whether it's because they need someone with a particular legal background or a particular skill set in another country, or because they're using this as a way to train up people to higher levels of responsibility. By the way, I should say it works the other way around too. American companies should care more about fair immigration policies so that gay employees overseas can be moved into the United States when they need them to move in the United States. But at the last time I looked at the sign-on letter, there were fewer than 20, I think it was 17 American companies that had signed on to support the Uniting American Families Act, which is the gay inclusive immigration reform bill. 17, you know. It's offensive to me. So in many respects, I see that companies, it's not even a question of asking them to stand on principle. They're not standing up for their own self-interest. And we need to do a better case in showing why this is important and how it can be done. Now let's take the harder case, the case of companies dealing with homophobic climates overseas where their employees are located. I would argue that corporate America has a broad interest in helping temper homophobic climates or reduce the level of homophobia wherever companies operate overseas. And this is not just for the benefit of their American employees that they transfer to those locations, who then have to live in those locations and work in those locations, but it's also for the benefit of local employees, because local employees tend to be the backbone of any company's foreign operations. But unlike the cases I mentioned earlier, where companies actually roll up their sleeves and they try to tackle the red tape issues and intellectual property rights infringements and things like that, there are very few companies that I'm aware of that really have sought to change in any material way homophobic climates overseas, or for that matter, discriminatory laws. There are a couple that I'm aware of. Levi Strauss was very good in filing a brief supporting the overturn of India's sodomy law recently. I understand that one particular company, I don't want to mention the name because I'm not sure about this one. I want to give credit where credit is not due. But I think that one particular company subsequent to that decision in India actually went in and negotiated insurance arrangements with Indian insurance companies for Indian gay employees, which I think is a great thing, showing that it can be done if you're committed. Now, I would suggest that when companies are not necessarily active in this sphere, the 5-minute rule, it may reflect or it may not reflect uncertainty about what can or cannot be done. to impact local laws or regulation. Companies, though, tend to be slow on any issue that might be controversial with one consumer group or another, and that more often than not, I think, is the reason they don't act. It's just the safest course from the standpoint of public relations or corporate image not to act if the issue is controversial. And so my takeaway is that while companies may be open to doing the right thing, it often takes a strong material motivation to get them interested to do so. And I think that rather than us expecting corporations to show progressive leadership, we have to be actively engaged in pushing them and showing them that material motivation for them, but also showing them why it would be worth their while to do it. I'll give you three lessons that I take away from all of this. The first lesson is that making a clear business case for action on a social issue is really important. We need to show how a company's failure to act inevitably will harm their interest or how by acting they will improve their interest. And for the issues that I'm working, that might, for example, mean stressing talent mobility. It might mean stressing talent retention. It doesn't mean stressing principle, even though principle is my personal motivation for involving myself in these issues. And we also have to be serious about that dialogue. This goes back to some of the discussions and the comments raised by Hyde this morning in her keynote. We can't just go in and make a list of demands and present them and then go out and face the cameras and then go out with our banners and so forth. We actually have to make an effort to try to convince them and to try to understand them and try to find where in their responses gives us an opening to actually achieve what we want to achieve. Lesson number two, our own commitment to social change and social progress has to be stronger than it sometimes is. I'm going to get in trouble for saying this, but for about 2 years, there are a number of us who've been involved in pressing the Human Rights Campaign, which is the United States' largest lesbian and gay, bisexual, transgender advocacy organization, to change its corporate equality index and to get them to start scoring companies that have international operations on the basis of what they do to promote LGBT fairness principles in those overseas locations. And we're still pretty much at square one, square zero, if there is such a thing. And I really don't think it's too much of an overreach for me to say that the principal impediment in this regard is that HRC doesn't want to anger its donor base. It's all about the money they're getting from the corporations, and now they're basically captive to those corporations. So I would ask them, where's the passion and where's the commitment to equality now? Those of us who stand in favor of social change and that want to see corporations take progressive action just have to do a better job at standing up for that value. And the third lesson and final lesson is that we need to think strategically also about when and how to engage the U.S. government as a partner in the efforts to seek social change through corporations. Now, I know that this conference has been framed, and correctly so, through the understanding that the government has ceded its role, its leading role, leadership role, in progressive social change. It's not the same as it was in the 60s. And that corporations may be freer to act and can act more than the government, is willing to act more than the government in some circumstances. I think all of that is definitely true. But why not take advantage of tools that only an administration can offer, that a receptive administration can and will offer? If you go back to my opening comments about diplomats, well, on LGBT policy, I think it's fair to say that embassies and companies overseas face the same obstacles when it comes to personnel policy. But a lot of those diplomats out there really would love to see some of these foreign countries change. And so why not propel the latter, propel the embassies to work with the corporations and the American Chambers of Commerce locally in different capitals around the world to actually achieve that change? There are also other ways of propelling this kind of action. The State Department has a range of tools, business councils, that they use for different purposes. And one of them is called the Overseas Security Advisory Council. It's a group of companies that meet with State Department representatives to talk about safety issues. So why not use that council to talk about safety and security of gay and transgender employees in overseas climates where being out and being gay is dangerous, is deadly dangerous. And why not also put gay and transgender issues onto the agenda of the Business Human Rights Roundtable that is hosted by the Undersecretary for Global Affairs? Corporations like to be asked to participate in these kinds of things. And if they're at the table, it's harder for them to resist at least sending a positive signal of willingness to be a partner in these efforts than if it's a one-on-one conversation. I throw these out as three examples of things that I'm actually working on now with the State Department. And the State Department is totally willing to do this, to try to engage corporations through these narrow windows, or these country-specific windows in some cases, to affect social change. But the point really is that these tools are available for any of the social issues that we care about. It's not just LGBT policy. We just have to take the effort to find what they are, find out about those tools, and think creatively how we can approach the administration and get the administration involved in doing the right thing. And that does take some effort, but if we find those points of intersection, it does help us leverage progress toward our goals. Now, thankfully, no one has flashed me the one-minute card yet, but I'm going to cede my remaining time, and thank you for your attention.
We have now some time for some questions. The mic is coming to you because this is being recorded.
Okay, first of all, I would like to thank the panel for your remarks and the different frameworks and paradigms that you laid out. My question is this, and it may be a time-dated question. I came from a period when on this campus, you know, four decades ago, our interaction, the progressive interaction with corporations was, you know, successfully keeping recruiters off this campus, you know, successfully demonstrating when Dow came to recruit people and to sell their wares. And colleagues and myself were later involved in the anti-apartheid divestment actions on various campuses internationally and nationally. And my question is this. You framed a lot of the kind of lessons and rules in the context of social justice. And although you've, at least one person has directly and indirectly, everyone has talked about human rights, my question is, what do you see as a kind of component within this framework for corporate roles in foreign policies in the countries where these, you know, US, UK, French-owned multinationals are operating? And is there an avenue within this foreign policy area to apply some of these lessons? And is there really a dividing line between progressive actors for social justice and progressive actors for equitable foreign policy options?
I'm going to give Michael a chance to think about the answer to this question because it seems sort of aimed at him. But let me just say that we're only here having this discussion in part because what you all did starting in the 60s, the anti-apartheid movement and the civil rights movement and the extent to which corporations were targeted, that was, you know, a crucial stage in this conversation. And you had a lot of success both in getting laws passed that required corporations to be responsible, but also in making the people who are in those corporations now, some of those folks were in the streets demonstrating back then.
Does that mean I have to answer now?
Yeah.
Listen, I appreciate the question very much because I also come from a framework where I think really human rights really has to be more central than it is. I made the remark earlier about how human rights is, the political scale is not always weighted like the scale of justice. And I think in the State Department, you have two dynamics. One is that the State Department focuses on economic development as opposed to necessarily our economic development goals and how those apply to foreign countries as opposed to necessarily the involvement of corporations, individual corporations. So they're happy to deal with corporations on things like corporate social responsibility, but they don't necessarily push the corporations in the way that I think State Department needs to push companies, particularly in countries where corporations really do play a larger-than-life role. You look at some countries like Nigeria, for example, oil companies have a huge, huge, huge resonance in those countries. And some of the companies, oil companies, actually score very poorly on the issue that I personally care about, LGBT equality issues. They score very poorly. I met an Exxon representative at a cocktail four nights ago in Washington by happenstance, and he said, "I heard the story about you leaving the State Department, and that's so terrible. Why would the department let you leave over an issue like LGBT issues?" And I looked at him and said, "You score zero on the HRC Corporate Equality Index, so why are you telling me this?" We could do more on, we as a government, sorry, could do much, much more to engage companies and to push them in the right direction if we wanted to. And I think absent that, I mean, part of what the council is doing is pushing the State Department to be more active and engage in companies. But absent that, I think all of us in this room and all the circles in which we travel, we have a role in doing that as well.
Doug? You know, the RUGI framework goes a long way to articulating the company obligation to respect human rights. But he also, at the same time, reasserts the government's role to protect human rights. And so here, in so doing, what he's saying is that governments have to step up and do more. And to the extent that one of the obstacles to respecting the rights of semi-skilled or unskilled laborers around the world, as an example, under difficult circumstances, is that there aren't, there isn't the government obligation to protect at hand. You know, Bangladesh is quite a dysfunctional government in that respect. So in ways that that RUGI reasserts the obligation to protect, and that the vehicles and the modalities of foreign policy, one country to another, can influence government's obligation to protect, it's a really very hopeful dynamic. And I would think that all governments should take it at very serious value and exercise it and integrate it into foreign policy considerations.
Okay. Other questions?
Yes. I have a question. You know, listening to your models about leverage, I was thinking about the article I read several months ago about workers committing suicide who were working on the iPhones in China because the demand was so high that they were, and they lived where they worked, that they'd rather just kill themselves than continue under those conditions. Whatever, we never heard what happened after that. You know, the report came out about the rise in suicide in that country, and whether you guys were familiar and whether the whole leverage stuff worked.
I do know a little bit about that. First of all, there was a cluster of suicides at Foxconn in China. I'm not sure there was a rise in suicide in that company. Right. So there were some disputes about whether Foxconn, which employed 400,000 workers in one factory complex, for example, whether the rates actually were. Foxconn, I think, is an incredibly interesting case, because if you walked into a Foxconn factory, I gather you'd be shocked. It does not look like what we think of as a sweatshop. Clean, modern, wages are higher than minimum wages in the country. It's not the bottom of the bottom. Those are sometimes the workers. And Honda, which also we read about in China, also a pretty high-end employer in the Chinese context. Those were the workers who were getting a lot of attention. They were empowered enough to demand, empowered enough to kill themselves? No, I guess not that. But the attention was focused on China because China has moved up the value chain and is demanding more than the basic minimum level. So in the meantime, you know, what happened? Wages have gone up quite significantly, both minimum wages and Foxconn wages specifically. There's been a lot, you know, that has focused attention in the Foxconn case on the sort of softer aspects of labor conditions. The biggest problem seems to be one of isolation and sort of the anomie associated with working, living all in this very, very regimented context. There weren't as many sort of classic labor standards violations in that factory as what you might find in other factories, what you might have found more of if you saw the movie Last Train Home, which has some, you know, real sweatshop conditions in China. It's an interesting case precisely because it shows a country that's moving up the value chain and can afford to worry about things like overly regimented working lives.
Len Speier, I'm a NYU alum. I want to thank you all. The panel has been very informative, this particular panel, and it raised some questions. I wonder whether the panel could help me out. I had experience talking about globalization and workforce in third world countries. I was on assignment some years ago with another photographer and a doctor to Suriname. Formerly Dutch Guiana. And I'm a lawyer, but I'm also a professional photographer. And we experienced the most horrible treatment of the workforce, really Neanderthal, in that country. The major occupation there are bauxite mines, and Suralco, Suriname Aluminum Company, controlled pretty much the company, the country, and the workforce was incredibly treated. We tried to photograph there, and we were refused permission. I wonder whether the panel has had any experience in that part of the world.
Sorry.
No experience in Suriname.
What's that?
No experience in Suriname. You know, I will say that the extractive industry in particular around the globe is unique in that when it engages in and invests in a mine or an oil or natural gas field or what have you, it is a significant impact on community. So, you know, a factory is four walls with 500 workers or 10,000 workers. A coal mine or a salt mine, an oil and gas field, could be hundreds of thousands of human beings and the environmental impacts that accrue as well. And in those cases, human rights have to also consider the range of impacts that are quite indirect and involve whole communities and support systems. And isn't often done, or done well, let's just say. So I don't have particular knowledge of those circumstances, but I know, and we all know, because we read about it in the papers, of corporate misbehavior by not paying enough attention to the wide variety of impacts that can accrue when corporations engage.
Let me just add one thing on that. One of the big problems in the extractive industries is also that it's very difficult to get that link between consumers and the product. That far down the supply chain, it's very difficult to get people to think of themselves as having any responsibility for the conditions under which the metal that then goes into the transistors or whatever. There's no accident that it's garment, it's footwear, it's toys, it's fancy software, and I mean fancy computer type equipment, which is still lagged behind. Where we've gotten the corporation to feel the pressure from consumers to improve labor standards.
Yeah, and I would just add, if I might use the moderator's prerogative here, that this is history that is our own history as well, which is to say, if we look at, say, child labor practices back in the early 20th century, you know, the Child Labor Act was passed in order to regulate, you know, conditions specifically in quarries and mines and, you know, as well as factories. And one of the issues, you know, Doug Kaiser is in the audience, he's written very eloquently on this process-product distinction, which is to say that one of the reasons why Congress was unable to regulate child labor was because the Supreme Court drew a distinction between the invidious processes that were, you know, engaged in to create the product and then the harmfulness of the product itself. And it said, so long as the good is innocent, then you can't regulate it as an article in interstate commerce. So this product process distinction is no longer part of our constitutional law, but it's certainly something, you know, as we've seen in our international law and in WTO distinctions. So. Great.
And they were pretty much indentured people.
Thank you.
I don't know if it's still that way.
In the interest of time, let's move to the next question. So, Nicole?
So, there had been the comment earlier about the potential simultaneous rise of the diversity officers and the privacy officers. And then, Professor Esslin, you had talked about sort of the role of actually supporting the kinds of arguments that people internally are trying to make, and that certainly comes up in the privacy context. I wondered how much in the CSR context in your work you're actually seeing the internal people coming from the social justice movement and actually being people who have come up through these ranks and are actually strong advocates inside the company versus coming from a business side and sort of just doing that job. Because we are seeing, at least in the privacy side, for, you know, sometimes it's helpful, sometimes it's not helpful, but that there is pretty heavy recruitment from sort of our own people into the companies, which sometimes can help. And as I said, sometimes they're not able to really do anything more. But I wonder, just from your perspective of the work that you're doing, whether you're seeing really real social justice people being put in power, having real power, or not. And if it has actually been effective in seeing more change in those companies from where they've come from. I think it's just an interesting question.
Yeah, thanks for the question. It really speaks to some of my toils and labors over the last 17 years. I think a lot of people got into this within the corporate world out of a true sense of activism and desire to be on the right side of the issues. There were those, of course, who were in denial, and we know about them because we've read about them. But when the movement first in earnest got started, mid-1990s, most of the people who were tasked with trying to figure this out were people who were genuinely motivated, but who weren't necessarily particularly well-versed in business process. The how to do it. But in those early years, what we were trying to do was to establish what the expectations ought to be. We were doing the benchmarking of International Labor Organization covenants. We were trying to figure out how to translate ILO covenants into compliance benchmarks and create very rudimentary audit systems and scale them over time. But as we became a bit more sophisticated in our thinking and understood what some of the obstacles were to that, then we needed the expertise in supply chain, in production processes. We needed more expertise in health and safety. We needed industrial hygienists to help us understand the impact of solvents on air quality. We needed more sophisticated thinking about communication systems, including grievance mechanisms, for protocols of how to listen to workers, how to do it in a way that wasn't intimidating, how to develop the policies with respect to non-retaliation so that we could be assured that when we were doing our work at creating better tools for assessment that we weren't engaging as well in unintended consequences. So we needed more, and today, as we move away from the world that Cynthia describes as the policing model to where one where we rely more on transparency and then working together with supply chains to improve conditions, we need people who desperately understand well how supply chains work, because we need to find better motivators up and down supply chains for the kinds of behaviors we want. The blame and shame game has played a very useful role in creating the awareness within corporations that this is something that the consuming public, the public at large, cares about. And by the way, so do the employees who walk through the door every morning of that corporation. No one wants to go home and sit around the family table and explain how, why that article appeared in the local newspaper. It's not a comfortable feeling. So there's the motivation has been created. And it's not to say that there are folks out there in the corporate world who have not yet heard the cry, let's say. But the leading brands, I chose my words carefully, leading brands and retailers have heard the cry. The question now is how to do it, and how to do it effectively. And the way to do that is to have sophisticated skills, to think about how to improve productivity on the lines and extract some of that enhanced productivity, some of that profit, and return it to enriching the lives of workers, not only the bottom line of the factory, the trading agent, the supplier, the licensee, the retailer, the brand, and into the consumer's pocket. So we started out in one place, and this movement has evolved dramatically, rapidly, and it's still very much a work in process, to where a whole host of slightly more technical skills are at play now and very, very much needed.
Can I just add a tiny bit on that point?
Please.
I believe very strongly in the importance of role, and so I think when activists get into those in-house CSR positions, their role pulls them toward the corporate perspective. They may get co-opted to some extent by the corporate message motivation to seek profits, but it works the other way also. People who got into that position from the business direction to do their job, they start going to conferences and becoming part of this larger professional community of CSR people. They too are pulled. This is a role that pulls people in two directions, and it works both ways, and it has to work both ways, because unless the two sides can work together, it's not going to be a sustainable and genuine kind of social responsibility program.
Where do you see the change happening more extensively? The people who start in social justice and learn the business, or the people who are the business people and then take in the social justice? You know, when I went to law school, it was like, well, are you a social justice lawyer, or are you a technology lawyer? Mm-hmm. And I said, I came to be a social justice technology lawyer. Mm-hmm.
Both.
You know, there's been this theme today about being good listeners to the other side in order to form better solutions. And sort of inherent in the notion of corporate responsibility is an understanding of a stakeholder community. And stakeholder communities exist within corporations, too. Corporations, while they may appear to be monolithic, are not, and individual performance isn't measured in any monolithic way. In fact, corporate performance at an individual level is often, individuals are often incented in ways that clash with others within the same corporation. So this kind of sharing and reaching out and understanding and creating a consolidated or even harmonized perspective I think there's real richness there and real possibility for finding solutions where everybody's pulling in the same direction.
The last question goes to the gentleman in the back.
Is this on? Can you hear me? Okay. My question is sort of a follow-up to that. The question deals with credibility from both sides. I guess there's two questions. The first is Professor Estlin suggested before, I think accurately, that corporate social responsibility programs are loath to engage in this sort of idea of a smaller, more contained set of factories and in a cooperative way with the anti-sweatshop movement, because they're worried about the anti-sweatshop movement running to the press at the earliest sign of some sort of labor exploitation or some sort of problem. So the first question is, how does the anti-sweatshop movement make their pledge to work cooperatively, and I'm talking about the workers themselves, advocates in developed countries, to work cooperatively to improve labor conditions so that there isn't that fear that you cannot cooperate because the NGOs will run right to the papers or run right to other decision makers. Second question is the credibility on the CSR side, which is that given that in countries like Bangladesh you have popular protests against, you know, to raise the minimum wage and so forth, and given the fact that so much of their economy depends on the ready-made garment industry, why would the government be, you know, either under-regulating or acting corruptly with regard to enforcing labor standards if they were reading the signs right from the corporate social responsibility movement? In other words, are they misconstruing and misunderstanding profoundly what corporations that source their product from Bangladesh are asking, or have they correctly read that those professed intentions are actually disingenuous intentions and instead have, you know, behaved accordingly? I don't know if that's clear, but basically, are they reading the signs improperly? In other words, and so corporations should be clearer in conveying their commitment to social responsibility, or have they correctly read those statements as disingenuous and not a true commitment to improving the rights of workers and the living and working conditions in their country?
I would just start. I'm sure that everybody has something to say about this, but I would say that it's more complicated than that, because I think depending on what is being produced in the nature of the work, some of it can be done by the lowest, least skilled workers. And so that work is going to be, it is going to flow, and we should probably be happy about that, to some environments where they desperately need development and jobs. But there's, so that it has something to do with the nature of the work, some of which the work can be done better and more productively by workers that have better conditions and are, you know, more invested and more experience. Part of it is strategic, though, because I think at any point, companies have to decide, okay, are we going to go with the low-cost strategy or are we going to go with the higher productivity strategy? And that's where the CSR pressures can tilt the balance in favor of, okay, you know, these are things that we can make it pay. We can get more productivity out of our supply chain if we stick with them, work with them, improve standards in a place where, you know, there are workers who've been doing this kind of work for a while. I think that's why, you know, a lot of this work is staying in China. So I don't think it's as simple as are they lying or are they telling the truth. And I think countries are struggling to get as much capital where they can, and there are layers of the production of product markets in which all that counts is the lowest cost production. There are other layers where all that counts, you know, what counts is really knowledge, sophistication, creativity, and then there's a lot in between where you can push companies to go one way or the other.
No reason to add much more to that. I agree with that. I would just say that most governments are pretty good at sort of packaging the facts the way they want to package them, emphasizing some truths and not stressing others. And so it's almost like gaming the system a little bit. I know very little about Bangladesh other than its propensity, according to friends of mine who've worked there, for corruption and not acknowledging hard truths. But that's the same, that same statement could apply to many, many other countries as well.
Yeah, I mean, I chose the Bangladesh example in my opening remarks because of its complexity. Precisely because I think through complexity we can draw some lessons, and the lessons from this case are that you know, brands acting alone, retailers acting alone, the multinationals won't solve the problems there, that there are many levels down, as Cynthia says, down and around, many other pressures that play into it. And I don't want to leave the multinationals off the hook. I mean, you can't berate a factory for driving excessive overtime in a factory when the same multinational has placed excessive orders knowingly in excess of capacity of that factory. So, you know, there's a lot of complicity, known or not quite known, all around. And in a place like Bangladesh, where you have strong control over the industry through export processing zones, they become, in a way, the regulators de facto in a weak government. And so you have a whole dynamic there in the EPZs that that plays a very important and not always helpful role.
Great. Please join me in thanking the panel.
Thank you again to our third panel, and I wanted to deliver a special thanks to Cynthia Esland and Professor Kenji Ishino, both of whom helped us brainstorm panelists for this symposium. And Kenji Ishino in particular is our faculty advisor, and he really helped us develop the symposium from start to finish. We couldn't have asked for a better faculty advisor for this symposium. He is, in fact, researching a book right now entitled Civil Rights, Inc., which is about how major corporations have become global engines for civil rights and human rights. So thank you, and closing remarks from Kenji Ishino, after which I hope you all will join us for a brief reception.
So thank you so much, Laura. I am allotted 15 minutes here for closing remarks, but I promise you it's going to be more like five so we can all get to the reception. I first wanted to give a ditto right back to Laura in terms of gratitude and respect. I would actually like all of the organizers from the journal, from the Review of Law and Social Change to be recognized. So the two symposium editors were Laura Moy and Megan Loisel. So if you could stand up, please, and be recognized. And Genevieve Lakier and Amalia Smyrnatopoulos. Where are you? There you are, so in the back. So I really just want to say two things. One, generally about the series, the Page to Practice series, and the other about the day that we've had today, this particular installment in the series. So many of you are not familiar with the series. I had the great privilege when I arrived at NYU Law School as a full faculty member a couple of years ago to be assigned to be the faculty advisor to the Review of Law and Social Change, long known to be a kind of clarion forum for progressive politics in what is, of course, one of the major liberal bastions in the legal academy. So it's a very liberal voice in a liberal forum. So I asked, I said, you know, I'm new here. Help me figure out what you're doing with these symposia. And they said, well, we have this very deep commitment to social justice. So I said, that's great, but you have to brand yourself a little bit more clearly than that if you want your series to sort of rise above the fray and cut through the noise. There are, after all, literally hundreds of law reviews publishing every year, having symposiums every year. And so what is it that makes you different? Let's, you know, brand this. And the answer was just really immediate and heartfelt, which is to say, that last year's editors-in-chief said, we believe that our distinctive contribution is that we close the gap in between scholarship and practice. So we want to call our symposium series a Page to Practice series, and to get the best academics and the best practitioners on a particular issue of social justice together under one roof to have a conversation that they otherwise would not be able to have, given that we're all in our independent silos in our day-to-day lives. So last year we kicked it off with a very successful symposium on reproductive justice, where top scholars working on reproductive rights issues came together with top practitioners, litigators, and policymakers who are actually on the ground working on these issues. And many of these individuals were meeting each other for the first time, even though they were, you know, citing each other all the time and sometimes corresponding with each other. They had actually never met face-to-face for this kind of conversation. So that was an enormous success. And then the law school made the unusual move of saying, we will fund you for consecutive year symposiums, and so have another one. And so we were left with the task of figuring out what the next topic would be. And it was really the brilliance of the four individuals that I've just mentioned to come up with this particular topic of thinking about corporate social responsibility and corporations as progressive actors. And I want to say that this took some courage, because for a very progressive journal to say we want to actually look at how corporations might be something other than the evil empire, right, in a school like NYU is a relatively controversial statement. And they caught a lot of resistance and flack for making that decision to have this be the symposium topic. So now moving to the events of today itself, I have no desire to summarize the events of today. I think that they really speak for themselves. I think it's been a very provocative series of discussions. I think the only thing I do want to say is to end where we began, where Professor Esslin said, when you look at this title, From Page to Practice, Corporations as Progressive Actors, I've explained the From Page to Practice part. She said, with respect to corporations as progressive actors, that there is a kind of invisible question mark after the subtitle of, can corporations actually accomplish the role of being progressive actors? And I guess all I want to say is that I think at the end of today, what we've realized, or at least what I've realized, is that I actually want to hang three question marks after that subtitle, Corporations as Progressive Actors, in the sense that each of those question marks could stand for the whole nest of questions that have been opened up by each of the three panels. But after that set of three question marks, I would like to add sort of three dots or an ellipsis saying this has to be a continuing conversation so that we can search for the answers to those conversations. And then finally, I would like to add three exclamation points. One exclamation point for the, you know, courage that it took to actually put on the symposium. One exclamation point for the brilliance of our panelists, and one exclamation point for the fact that we can celebrate a job well done with the cocktail reception that is to come. Thank you very much.